And so, just to find a way, there's consistency across all dispensaries. I think that's something that's not really spelled out in the rule, where a patient walking into dispensary A is seeing and reading something very similar to what they're seeing in dispensary Z. So there's no confusion.
I think it goes well beyond this problem, because as I brought up a couple hours ago, how do we train the cultivators if they had access to this information, which is listed in very simple ways? Look at these strains are turning out to be amongst our 40 centers and our 2,400 patients or 24,000 patients in the state of Ohio. This one's working really well over here for pain. This one's working really over here, you know, for whatever. The cultivators would have that access to that information too, just as quickly, and they could say, "Oh, well, we better start producing more of this plant, this variety." So I think it could be a nice feedback and very timely one. So it's a great idea.
And it helps defray some of the exposure and the cost, right? And I think that's the undercurrent. I don't want to keep harping on it. If indeed there is the requirement that the physician have these same drug interaction discussions, and then the medical director is having the same discussions, and both of them are sharing a lot of the significant exposure that's associated with both of those tasks in addition to others, it is going to require significant cost, and that will end up being borne one way or another by the patient.
If I could, your research and what the other states are doing, do we run into an issue where a particular cultivator or processor has copyrighted materials and markets their products in such a way that could get in the way of this type of collaboration?
Well, there's a couple of different things. It's A, where the vertical integration has been so successful in this industry, because it not only takes advantage of natural efficiencies that are then passed on to the consumer, but it also increases the information sharing that I think we're all wanting. So if indeed I'm a cultivator and I own a dispensary as well, I inherently know and have a direct patient feedback loop that then can increase not only the effectiveness of being able to serve the market, ensure that certain conditions, those conditions that are most prevalent in my dispensary, are met with the best possible medicine to meet those conditions, but then also encourages and creates a patient feedback loop that can benefit doctors as well. So there tends to be, the more the system is predicated on participation, particularly physician participation and really preserving the doctor-patient relationship, the more that starts to show up in a successful program that actually has, again, the financial incentives to contribute towards research and do those other things, rather than just hanging on by a thread until hoping that the market changes, which we've seen in states that haven't been successful.
Thank you. I just wanted to affirm your thought on the value of consistent information amongst the dispensaries. And I think that will start to lead us to appropriate information for all patients with this program. Shares not only the most current, but the most accurate information.
Okay. Other comments there? Questions? All right. We'll pivot now into 6317, which we're in the surveillance and security. Obviously, it's important. I think the rules. Then 6318, record keeping requirements. Typical for record keeping in general in our industry. So, questions around that? 6319, confidentiality. I think Aaron did a good job with that, explaining where we have to honor all of the confidentiality and where it may be made discoverable based upon work that might be happening at certain regulatory levels. Comments? 6320, training. So this is one where what should a person look like before they work in one of these dispensaries?
I have a question on that. Is there a uniform curriculum that we're going to follow, or is it sort of up to each dispensary department?
It would be up to the dispensary's discretion as long as they're compliant with what's in here. You'll see that they're training, just like CMEs are developing over there. It's similar for employees of dispensaries as well.
Okay. comments, questions, and training. 6321, inventory control, critical in any pharmacy-like operation, but in this particular case, if they need more critical. Again, very prescriptive. Yeah, Nancy.
On that one, where you have that it's required on a weekly basis, is that also parallel to what happens in pharmacies with narcotics now?
That is not. Pharmacists are required to conduct an inventory on an annual basis.
Annual basis.
Let me just shake that a bit. While the rule may stipulate that, I think you will find universally, particularly in controlled substance arena, from an operational standpoint, we are inventorying much more aggressively than that. I would say that a weekly inventory in this case would not be that far off from the rest of our Schedule II inventory processes in pharmacies in general. We're pretty rigorous in that space.
Just to point out, that inventory could just as easily, maybe even more easily, happen by weight than it would be by counting individual packages.
In this particular case, I would think it would be possible from a plant material perspective. Oils, probably more by volume.
And I should clarify, patch by all means, I'm talking about
plant material. Yeah.
By all means. I mean, nobody's expecting that you're going to get a vat of oil and then you've got to fill it up each individual container. I'm talking about that.
Inventory control, other questions? Okay. Moving on to 6322, recall. I have to say I had not thought about this, although I deal with recalls all the time as drugs are recalled. So the reason we should not have a recall process, I just expect it will happen. And again, it's really pretty well spelled out there. Any questions around what the obligation might be? Okay. 6323 prohibitions, in general, it's more of a general.
Yes. I know we have a number of comments in this space. Michael, go ahead.
There's a prohibition against transporting medical marijuana to a patient. There's no prohibition against transporting a patient to the dispensary?
No, there's no prohibition against that.
James, yes.
So this is a major issue, particularly as we've already identified that if we've got 88 counties and only 40 dispensaries, that one of the discussions throughout the drafting of HB 523, particularly in cannabis legislation, you tend to see the ability for home grow, if indeed you have patients or dispensaries who are not located within 25 miles. It's a very common practice. So having such a few number of dispensaries, having delivery is something that has been critical in states that have so few dispensaries. It's even seen very prevalently in states that have large numbers of dispensaries, because those who may be homebound and don't have designated caregivers, and or who don't want a designated caregiver, it's proven to be an incredibly important part of a functioning program. And I would advocate very strongly on behalf of my constituency that be removed.
What I'll say in that regard is that, you know, the Department of Commerce has worked really hard to build in security measures to and diversion prevention measures in the transportation of marijuana. And right now, that's where we see in Ohio's program the transportation of marijuana being limited to.
Sorry, Jerry, go ahead.
This actually goes back to a comment that Michael asked earlier regarding E, where it says no dispensary shall sell anything. There are other complementaries that they may want to sell. You know, I'm thinking, you know, what if they wanted to sell branded hats or t-shirts or something like this? This would then prohibit that. This seems fairly restrictive to me in terms of running a business.
Mm-hmm. So the term paraphernalia is something that is used in the bill. It's not defined in the bill. And that rule is not intended to prevent things like that. So like the advertising type materials, if they have, you see a pen, for instance, that's branded, and if they're selling their pens that are branded, so long as the advertising on it is approved, it would be authorized as probably paraphernalia.
How, How about other complimentaries like snacks or drinks?
No, there's a prohibition on the
selling it or consuming it.
To sell it.
What about over-the-counter vitamins?
No. That's not anticipated under here.
Is that by statute?
No, it would be under the rules.
That seems fairly restrictive. Just, you know.
Folks that...
I mean, other retail pharmacies sell all variety of things. I mean, if you go into Walgreens, you go into CVS, it's essentially now a grocery store, and that drives the profitability of that underlying business. I mean, really what you're doing is you're taking away complementaries and other ways that you can actually make a successful business case for this.
And I think what you see when you look at other states with medical programs is that there are restrictions on what can be sold at the dispensary, and typically they are limited. They're not allowed to sell food and beverages at their dispensaries. This isn't unlike other modern medical marijuana programs.
What is the perceived harm of selling other products within the dispensary?
Well, we're trying to, we do want to limit them to a medical facility, a medical establishment. They're not intended to be, to have separate departments, like, for instance, your CVS or your Walgreens, where the pharmacy department shuts down and the convenience store portion remains open. That's something that we're not interested in having in Ohio's program at this time.
And even in a CVS, that barrier is separately licensed by the Board of Pharmacy, and the requirements for storage and operation of that pharmacy operation are significantly different than the rest of the store that sells other things that's likely separately licensed, separately permitted, and merging the two in this space is not something that we certainly welcome the feedback.
What?
So I really appreciate all the work that you guys have put into this. It's obvious that you're working very hard on trade-offs, and that's what all of this is about trade-offs. My concern on some of the rules of the dispensaries is, number one, it sounds like they're not going to be in any healthcare facility. So on one hand, you're saying you want it to be like a healthcare facility, but on the other hand, it's not going to be allowed. Then you're saying you want it to be more like retail, but then you're not going to allow other things on retail. I think it's going to be a very big challenge for these dispensaries to make a business case to even be open. And I'm just worried that we're creating a model that's not going to be economically successful.
Is there any latitude in the description of the space? I don't remember where it is in the rule, but there is the general building. Then there's the space where the marijuana is actually housed. What are we calling those two spaces?
There's a dispensary department, and then there is the restricted access within the dispensary department.
Okay, so there's some delineation by rule of there's a really tightly controlled space, and there's kind of a not so tightly controlled space. Okay, I hadn't forgotten what that really was like. I'm sorry, yeah.
So, and I don't mean this flippantly at all, because I am in full agreement that only licensed individuals who have an ID card should be allowed into a dispensary. Right. But what we see with cannabis legislation, I'm even in favor of you selling nothing but everything that's on this list. But if you make the program so restrictive that that's going to limit the number of people who even have that opportunity, you're dooming it to be unsuccessful to take advantage of the other revenue streams that they're talking about. So if you do both, right, you end up creating a system that is going to fail. They just don't have enough revenue coming in to survive. And so the reason why we see in cannabis legislation a willingness for participants to accept this type of heavy regulation is because they can meet those demands because of the profitability of the businesses, because there's adequate patient participation. And without it, it's a recipe for a failed system and a tremendous amount of capital loss and a tremendous amount of people being underserved by a statute that was meant to provide this medicine to people.
Well, as you mentioned, the compromise, as you all think of this, if you think there is room for compromise and you have specific ideas, we'd really love to hear.
I guess I come at it, I understand, and I support the fact that we want businesses to be healthy and successful. On the other hand, I know that when we first started exploring the marijuana issue in California, you go into a dispensary and it looked like a party store. So what you're doing with that kind of a system is setting up to the community that this isn't medicine, this is party time. And so we want to keep medicine as medicine and not do that social norming that this is something that everybody should be doing. And that's why I'm against the t-shirts and the hats and the things like that. That shouldn't be coming out of the store. If you're doing anything in the store, it should be medical supplies. Maybe it's first aid kits. Maybe it's, you know, Kleenex. Maybe it's, you know.
That's not allowed.
Well, I'm not saying that I'm offering that as a suggestion. You know, as opposed to things that end up being party type of things that normalizes.
Can we have the audience settle just a bit, please?
So that's from my side. That we just, if we do it, we want the companies to be successful. But this is medicine, and let's treat it as medicine, and not as a party store. And let's do whatever we might be able to do to help it compromise the situation.
I'd also like to add, if you do have, you know, I wasn't advocating for the party store.
Yeah, sure. I know.
If you did have something like that, and I'll tell you, in rural Ohio and probably many urban parts of Ohio, if you have a place like that, you won't have physician participation because you'll have the negative financial impact on a physician where you may lose patients if you're licensed to prescribe or recommend, and that is what they look like.
You're 100% right, and Marcy, you're absolutely correct, and it is what we saw happen in Massachusetts. So that if we have a restrictive medical program, what is coming is recreational marijuana. There's no doubt about it. We see it over and over and over again. If you do not create a successful medical marijuana program where people have access, where patients have access and physicians are participating, then in a state that has a referendum and the ability to have a constitutional amendment like Ohio, 13 out of 18 have done it through the ballot initiative for medical, and then 5 of those turned around that did it for recreational for reasons just like this.
Okay. I would say in that sentence where you use the word paraphernalia, I would rather see complementary medical stuff, whatever it's called, because that would keep the notion of it being in a place where you can access complementary solutions.
Okay.
Yes.
Come on that as public comment comes in. Okay. 6324, dispensary access and security around that, when you can come in and not come in.
Curtis?
Yes, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Going backwards? Yes, go ahead.
I have to say about the home delivery, I had one question. Are opiates allowed to be delivered to home, opiate prescriptions?
There is no prohibition today that I'm aware of that opiate or that controlled substances cannot be delivered to patients' homes.
So a terminally ill patient, homebound.
Morphine can be delivered to them today through a variety of means, whether personal delivery or UPS or mail. It does happen today, yes.
So if our statute doesn't restrict it, I would really like you to think about the access to families that have limited availability to go to 40 places from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and have other opportunities to access them.
And there are control processes around that today.
With their physician guidance.
It's not like getting a letter in your mailbox. There is control processes around it that do exist today. I'm sorry, Jason.
Yeah, I just, before we move on, something I've been thinking about, as Nancy said, that with these restrictions on ways that people can get this medicine, at the very beginning of this topic, we were talking about concerns about patient flow, about the number of sites. I feel like if we are concerned about who the, you know, these are trained, educated, licensed employees that are being strictly scrutinized, that there are ways to deliver and provide access, whether it's through a drive-through window or through delivery.